Current music director of the Connecticut Gilbert and Sullivan Society. Since its founding in 1981, our society has presented one work of this famous pair every year. This year, 2020, we will not be able to continue this tradition because of the closings and physical separation necessitated by the COVID-19 outbreak. So instead, we will be coming to you through this video virtually, featuring many of the talented members of our past casts, presenting selections from each of the 14 works in the repertoire, with a bit of backstory thrown in. We hope you will enjoy this program, and we will be looking forward to returning to our traditional presentations next year. We have opened with a selection from the first collaboration of Gilbert and Sullivan, Thespis. William Gilbert was at this time a successful playwright and producer of works for the stage, and Sullivan, an up-and-coming composer. They were successfully brought together by John Hollingshead to produce a holiday entertainment for London's Gaiety Theatre for the Christmas season of 1871 through 1872. Sullivan had previously rejected invitations to work with Gilbert on other projects, but fortunately, this time, he agreed. The plot line concerns a troupe of play actors who meet up with the aging gods of classical mythology on Mount Olympus and agree to take on their roles for a year while the gods go down to Earth to try to modernize. Needless to say, chaos results. Though the libretto Thespis was published and survives, all but two of the musical numbers and the ballet music have disappeared. What you just heard, the chorus climbing over Rocky Mountain, is one of the two surviving pieces. It was later modified and reused in Pirates of Penzance. So now let our journey continue.
I am John Friedman, Connecticut Gilbert and Sullivan Society Vice President and Producer. 4 years would pass before Gilbert and Sullivan once again joined forces. This time they were brought together by impresario Richard Doyley Cart, who would be the manager and producer for the remainder of their joint output. The one-act work, Trial by Jury, the only one with no spoken dialogue, was to round out a program at the Royalty Theater, whose main piece was the Offenbach light opera La Pericole. Trial premiered March 25th, 1875. It didn't take long for it to become more popular than the Offenbach piece, and it continued to run long after La Pericole closed, racking up an astounding 300 performances. Publicity for the show emphasized the composition of Sullivan, making little mention of Gilbert. This was to have unfortunate repercussions in the later relations. The story, based on a then-current scandalous trial, concerns a broken engagement and a bitter squabbling couple, with the would-be bride suing her intended for breach of promise of marriage. She appears at the proceedings in her wedding gown, accompanied by an entourage of her bridesmaids. I am playing her attorney, who's about to detail to the court the anguish the jilted bride has suffered at the cruel and insensitive hands of her erstwhile intended.
May it please you, my lord, gentlemen of the jury, with a sense of deep emotion, I approach this painful case. For I never had a notion that a man could be so base. All to see a girl confiding vows, etc., deriding. See my interesting client, victim of a heartless wile. See the traitor, all defiant, wear a supercilious smile. Sweetly smiled my client on him, coyly wooed and gently won him.
Sweetly smiled his client on him, coyly wooed and gently won him.
Swiftly fled each honeyed hour, spent with this unmanly male. Camberwell became a bower, Peckham an Arcadian vale. Breathing concentrated Otto, an existence a la Watto.
Breathing concentrated Otto, an existence a la Watto.
Picture then my client naming and insisting on a day. Picture him excuses framing, going from afar away. Doubly criminal to do so, for the maid had bought a trousseau.
Doubly criminal to do so, for the maid had bought a trousseau.
Cheer up, my pretty old.
Cheer up, cheer up, we love you.
Cheer up, cheer up.
Cheer up, cheer up, we love you.
Cheer up,
we love you.
Cheer up.
Hello, I'm Alan Church, and I'm going to tell you some things about the next step in the career of Gilbert and Sullivan. Following the success of Trial by Jury, Doyle Cart convinced the pair, plus several other backers, to form the Comedy Opera Company and leased the Opera Comique Theater. Trial was transferred to the new theater, and rather than pair it up with more Offenbach, it was decided that Gilbert and Sullivan would write their own two-act opera, this time with dialogue to accompany it. The result was The Sorcerer, which opened November 17, 1877, and which was to have an initial run of 178 performances. The storyline that Gilbert devised was one he would return to, or try to return to, often, involving a magic love potion that causes whoever should partake of it to fall madly in love with the first person he or she should see. Of course, in true Gilbert fashion, this leads to a lot of comical mismatches. Probably the best known number from Sorcerer is "My name is John Wellington Wells," during which the title character introduces himself and describes the available services in what is arguably the first of the famous patter songs, which would become almost synonymous with the Gilbert and Sullivan style. My name is John Wellington Wells from The Sorcerer.
My name is John Wellington Wells. I'm a dealer in magic and spells, in blessings and curses and ever-filled purses and prophecies, witches and elves. And if anyone anything lacks, if you want a proud bow to make tracks, you've got to look in the resident gin number 70 Simmery Axe. We've a first-rate assortment of magic, and for raising a posthumous shade, with effects that are comic, tragic, there's no cheaper house in the trade. Love filters, we've quantities of it, and for knowledge if anyone burns, we're keeping a very small profit, a profit which brings us unbounded returns. For he can prophesy with the wink of an eye, peep with security into futurity, sum up your history, clear up a mystery, ram with proclivity for a nativity, for a nativity. With answers oracular, bogey spectacular, tetrapods tragical, mirrors so magical, facts astronomical, solemn or comical, and if you want it, he makes the reduction on taking a quantity. Oh! If anyone anything lacks, he'll find it already in stacks. He's but to look in the resident gin number 70 Simmery Axe. He can raise you hosts of ghosts, and that without reflectors, and creepy things with wings, and gaunts and grisly specters. He can fill you crowds of shrouds, and horrify you vastly, and rack your brains with chains, and gibberings grim and ghastly. Then if you planety changes organity with an urbanity full of satanity, vexes humanity with an inanity fatal to vanity, driving your foes to the verge of insanity. Barring tautology, in demonology, electrobiology, mystic nosology, spirit philology, high cause astrology, such is his knowledge, isn't the man to require an apology? My name is John Wellington Wells. I'm a dealer in magic and spells, in blessings and curses and ever-filled purses and prophecies, witches and knells. And if anyone anything lacks, he can find it already in stacks. He's but to look in the resident gin number 70 Simmery Axe.
Hi, I'm Kathleen Thompson, and I'm here to talk about the first Gilbert and Sullivan international mega hit, HMS Pinafore. Pinafore satirizes the English social class system by setting a love story aboard a British man-of-war moored in Portsmouth Harbor. An ordinary seaman, Rafe Rackstraw, and a wealthy captain's daughter, Josephine, have fallen in love. Unfortunately, Josephine has also caught the eye of the elderly Sir Joseph Porter, who's the First Lord of the Admiralty. Now, he believes that a British seaman is anyone's equal, except his, of course, even though how he got to his position wasn't exactly by merit. This encourages Rafe and Josephine to elope. The plot is foiled when the captain discovers it. Now, it wouldn't be a Gilbert and Sullivan operetta without a surprise. So it turns out that the captain and Rafe, when they were babies, were exchanged for each other by their nursemaid. When their true identities are revealed, Sir Joseph, believing that love doesn't level all ranks quite as much as that, rescinds his marriage proposal, which allows Rafe and Josephine to marry. Now, you know how I said that HMS Pinafore was the first mega hit by Gilbert and Sullivan? Well, it wasn't right away. When it opened in May of 1878, it was about to close until Sullivan conducted a selection of tunes from the opera at the Promenade Concerts at Covent Garden. This led to Pinafore mania, with competing theater companies pirating the show and putting on their own productions both in Great Britain and in the U.S. HMS Pinafore is still one of Gilbert and Sullivan's most popular works. Yes, it's a satire, and it's also a love story at heart. My selection, Sorry Her Lot, expresses Josephine's longings when she believes her love is hopeless.
Aldrich, and I am here to tell you about Gilbert and Sullivan's next creation, the very popular Pirates of Penzance. Their previous work, HMS Pinafore, became an international hit, having unauthorized performances on both sides of the Atlantic, most of which did not pay royalties to Gilbert and Sullivan. Gilbert and Sullivan's opera company agreement expired, and they, along with Doyle Cart, formed the Doyle Cart Opera Company, Faced with lost income on previous works, Gilbert and Sullivan decided that their next operetta would simultaneously open in New York and England to secure copyrights in both countries. Gilbert and Sullivan traveled to the U.S. with the stated purpose of staging Pinafore, but really planned to stage a new work when they arrived. The plan succeeded, with Pirates of Penzance opening in New York on New Year's Eve, 1879. This work was so popular that several touring companies were organized to meet the demand. Pirates of Penzance focuses on the theme of steadfastness to duty. It centers around the young man Frederick, who is an apprenticed pirate. He has reached his 21st birthday and thus fulfilled his apprenticeship. He decides to leave piracy for a more respectable career. He stumbles upon the many daughters of the Major General Stanley, all of whom reject him, except for one by the name of Mabel. Mabel and Frederick are about to get married when Frederick is told by his former pirate commander that he was born on leap year, and he won't actually be 21 until the year 1940. Devastated by the news that Frederick must return to piracy, Mabel vows to be faithful till Frederick's return. At the end of the operetta, it is revealed that all the pirates were just noblemen who have gone wrong, and the pirates give up their corrupt lives to marry the general's daughters. Frederick and Mabel are able to be happily married. One of the most popular pieces from this tuneful score is Mabel's infamous coloratura aria, Poor Wandering One.
Hi there. My name is Spencer Reese, and I am Artistic Director of Connecticut Gilbert and Sullivan Society. More than a year would pass after the premiere of Pirates before it was replaced at the Opera Comique. Gilbert's next idea for an original story was to satirize the Church of England, personified by two feuding clergymen. Now, he eventually realized that this plot may not be received well, and so he turned instead to the aesthetic movement, which was sweeping artistic circles at the time, by the likes of the poet Swinburne, the artist Whistler, and author and playwright Oscar Wilde. The result was Patience, a show about two rival poets. Now, within the story, all of the upper-class young women are totally enamored with these two poets, and they've collectively turned their backs on their former love interests, a troop of dragoon soldiers. The poets, on the other hand, have turned their attention to the town's innocent, though somewhat clueless milkmaid, whose name is Patience. To help familiarize American audiences with the oddities of the aesthetic movement, Doyle Cart actually sponsored an American lecture tour by Oscar Wilde. Another milestone would be reached on December 28, 1881, when Patience would be moved to a newly built theater called the Savoy, which was the first theater ever to be lit by electric light. From then on, all of the Doyle Cart Opera Company productions, as well as Gilbert and Sullivan's original productions, would be staged at the Savoy. Even to this day, fans of Gilbert and Sullivan are still referred to as Savoyards. I will now take on the role of the jaded poet Reginald Bunthorne as he makes a startling admission.
Am I alone and unobserved? I am. Then let me own, I'm an aesthetic sham. This air severe is but a mere veneer. This cynic smile is but a wile of guile. This costume chaste is but good taste misplaced. Let me confess, a languid love for lilies does not blight me. Lank limbs and haggard cheeks do not delight me. I do not care for dirty greens by any means. I do not long for all one sees that's Japanese. I am not fond of uttering platitudes and stained glass attitudes. In short, my medievalism's affectation, born of a morbid love of admiration. If you're anxious for to shine in the high aesthetic line as a man of culture rare, you must get up all the germs of the transcendental terms and plant them everywhere. You must lie upon the daisies and discourse in novel phrases of a complicated state of mind. The meaning doesn't matter if it's only idle chatter of a transcendental kind. And everyone will say, as you walk your mystic way, if this young man expresses himself in terms too deep for me, why, what a very singularly deep young man this deep young man must be. Be eloquent in praise of the very dull of days which have long since passed away, and convince him, if you can, that the reign of good Queen Anne was culture's palmiest day. Oh, of course you will poo-poo whatever's fresh and new, and declare it crude and mean, for I'll stop short in the cultivated course of the Empress Josephine. And everyone will say, as you walk your mystic way, if that's not good enough for him, which is good enough for me, why, what a very cultivated kind of youth this kind of youth must be. Then a sentimental passion of a vegetable fashion must excite your languid spleen. An attachment a la Plato to a bashful young potato, or a not too French bean. Though the Philistines may jostle, you may rank as an apostle of the high aesthetic band, if you walked on Piccadilly with a poppy or a lily in your medieval hand. Everyone will say, as you walk your flowery way, if he's content with a vegetable love, which would certainly not suit me, why, what a most particularly pure young man this pure young man must be.
Hello, my name is David Shancup, and I'm going to tell you the background on the next of the Gilbert and Sullivan operas, Iolanthe. Patience was a great success in its London run, with 578 performances, as many as Pinafore, and more than Pirates of Penzance. Its success brought great wealth to its creators, who now had annual incomes greater than the Prime Minister of Great Britain. Even so, by the end of the summer of 1882, it became apparent that a new work was called for. This time, the satirical target would be the British Parliament, in particular, the House of Lords, referred to in the script as the House of Peers. The story centers around Strephon, whose father was mortal and whose mother, the title character Iolanthe, was a fairy. As a result, he is a fairy down to the waist, but his lower half is mortal. He is in love with the shepherdess Phyllis, who is so beautiful that she has completely captivated the whole House of Peers, though her heart is set on Strephon. However, being the ward of the Lord Chancellor, she cannot marry without his consent, which he withholds since he himself is smitten by her. In revenge, the Queen of the Fairies sends Strephon, who is, unbeknownst to the Lord Chancellor, his son by Iolanthe, to whom he was once long ago married, into Parliament, where because of his magical powers, he can make the vote any way he wants. One of the most famous patter songs in the repertoire occurs during the second act, as the lovelorn Lord Chancellor, who is turned between his love for Phyllis and his responsibilities as her guardian, explains how he is haunted by bizarre nightmares.
Love, unrequited, robs me of me to rest. Love, hopeless love, my ardent soul encumbers. Love, nightmare-like, lies heavy on me chest and weaves itself into my midnight slumbers. You're lying awake with a dismal headache and repose is tabooed by anxiety. I conceive you may use any language you choose to indulge in without impropriety. For your brain is on fire and the bedclothes conspired of usual slumber to plunder you. First your counterpane goes and uncovers your toes, then the sheet slips demurely from under you. The blanketing tickles, you feel like mixed pickles, so terribly sharp is the pricking. And you're hot and you're cross and you tumble and toss till there's nothing twixt you and the ticking. Then the bedclothes will creep to the ground and peep and pick them all up in a tangle. Next your pillow resigns and politely declines to remain at its usual angle. Well, you get some repose in the form of a doze, without eyeballs and head ever aching. But your slumbering team with such horrible dreams, you very much better be waking. For you dream you are crossing the channel and tossing about in a steamer from Haddage, which is something between a large bathing machine and a very small second-class carriage. And you're giving a treat, penny ice and cold meat, to a party of friends and relations. They're a ravenous horde, and they all came on board at Sloane Square and some Kensington stations. Then bound on your journey, you find your attorney, who started that morning from Devon. He's a bit undersized, and you don't feel surprised when he tells you he's only 11. Now you're driving like mad with a singular lad. By the ship's now a four-wheeler. And you're playing round games, and he calls you bad names when you tell him the ties by the dealer. Well, this you can't stand, so you throw up your hands, and you find you're as cold as an icicle. In your shirt and your socks, the black silk with gold clocks, crossing Salisbury Plain on a bicycle. And he and the crew are on bicycles too, which they somehow or other invested in. And he's telling the tars of the particulars of a company he's interested in. It's a scheme of devices to get at low prices, or Gustenkopf mixtures to cables, which tickles the sailors by treating retailers as though they were all vegetables. You get a good spaceman to plant a small tradesman, first take off his boots with a boot tree, and his legs will take root, and his fingers will shoot, and they'll blossom and bud like a fruit tree. From the greengrocer tree, your great grapes and bucolic cauliflower pineapple and cranberries. Of the pastry cook blanc cherry brandies will grant apple buffs and three corners and bambinis. The shares at a penny and ever so many are taken by Rothschild and Baring. And just as a few are allotted to you, you awake with a shudder despairing. You're a regular wreck with a crick in your neck, and no wonder you snore, for your head's on the floor. You've needles and pins from your soles to your shins. Your flesh is a creep and your left leg's asleep. It's a pant in your toes and a fly on your nose, some fluff in your lung and a fever in your tongue, and a thirst is intense in the general sense that you haven't been sleeping in over. But the darkness has passed, it's daylight at last. The night has been long, ditto, ditto, my song. And thank goodness they're both of them over.
Hello, I'm Erin Aldrich, and I'm here to tell you about Princess Ida. Princess Ida premiered at the Savoy Theater on January 5th, 1884. It is the only one of Gilbert and Sullivan's operas to exceed two acts, as it begins with a 40-minute prologue. The theme is women's education. The story is based on a narrative poem by Alfred Lord Tennyson, which Gilbert had previously adapted as a tongue-in-cheek stage play. He convinced Sullivan to adapt the play to music. The dialogue is taken directly from the play, and thus is the only one of their works in which the dialogue is in blank verse, much like Shakespeare. Because of the two intermissions, it has a longer running time than any of the other operas. The music in this opera is of exceptional quality, and the middle section is often referred to as the String of Pearls. In a nutshell, Princess Ida deals with, well, Princess Ida, who wants absolutely nothing to do with men, so much so that she founded a women's boarding school in a fortified castle where even the mention of men is forbidden. The problem is that she was engaged to Prince Hilarion when she was a baby, and when she doesn't show up to the scheduled wedding, Prince Hilarion and two of his friends decide to infiltrate the school. After painfully scaling the walls, they disguise themselves as female students, hoping to win over Princess Ida's affections. They encounter a professor, Lady Psyche, who describes to them the basic principle that man sprung from an ape is ape at heart.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Sierra Manning, and I have the pleasant task of bringing you a selection from one of Gilbert and Sullivan's most popular works. By late summer of 1883, attendance at the Savoy Theater was falling off, and it was time for a new work to be brought forward. Gilbert approached Sullivan with several plot ideas, many involving a magic lozenge, akin to the plot of The Sorcerer. Sullivan adamantly refused to set any plot involving magic. Gilbert happened by chance to visit a Japanese exhibition in a London suburb and was greatly impressed with displays of Japanese culture. He was inspired by this experience to set a story in Japan. The result was the Mikado, the story of the romance of Nanki Poo, the son of the Emperor of Japan disguised as a wandering minstrel, and the lovely schoolgirl Yum Yum. Unfortunately, Yum Yum is claimed in marriage by her guardian Coco, the Lord High Executioner. But Coco has been remiss in his duties and must now find somebody to execute. Nanki Poo, who is about to commit suicide in despair, volunteers to be the victim, provided he can spend a month as Yum Yum's husband first. On the morning of her wedding day, Yum Yum modestly describes her own beauty, comparing it to that of the sun and the moon.
Hello, my name is Michael Loomis, and I will continue the Gilbert and Sullivan saga. The Mikado turned out to be an incredible success. Not only was it popular in the English-speaking world, but also in Scandinavia and Germany. In fact, there was a town in Michigan that was even named Mikado in the show's honor. The London run encompassed an unheard of 672 performances. Now, it was almost a full 2 years before Gilbert and Sullivan were called upon to produce a new work, Sullivan, meanwhile, had enjoyed a significant success with his oratorio, The Golden Legend, and was now regarded as England's premier composer. For his new project, Ruddigore, Gilbert turned to popular melodrama with its stock characters of evil landowners, maidens in distress, heroic seamen, and the supernatural. Unfortunately, Mikado proved a hard act to follow, and Ruddigore's merits were not so immediately apparent. There was some audience dissatisfaction at the early performances, and compared to Mikado, the run of Ruddigore was only 288 performances, still a respectable figure. Now, one of the most stunning scenes in Ruddigore occurs in Act Two, when the portraits of ancestors come to life and step down from their frames to torment the protagonist. Their leader, Sir Roderick, explains that the life of a ghost is not really all that dull.
When the night wind howls in the chimney cowls, and the bat in the moonlight flies, and inky clouds like funeral shrouds sail over the midnight skies, when the footpads quail at the night bird's wail, and black dogs bay at the moon, then is the specter's holiday, then is the ghost I know. Sob of the breeze sweeps over the trees, and the mist lies low on the fens. From grey tombstones are gathered the bones that once were women and men. And away they go with a mop and a mow to the revel that ends too soon. For cockcrow limits our holiday, the dead of the night's high noon. The dead of the night's high noon, high noon. The dead of the night's high noon. And then each ghost with his lady toast to their churchyard beds take flight, with a kiss perhaps on her lantern chaps, and a grisly grim good night, till the welcome knell of the midnight bell rings forth its dolliest tune, and ushers in our next high holiday, the dead of the night's high noon, the dead of the night's high noon.
Hello, my name is Julie Rumbold, and I'm going to talk to you about The Yeoman of the Guard, one of my personal favorites. You could never tell what would inspire Gilbert for ideas. In this case, inspiration came from an advertisement at a train station by the Tower Furnishing Company. The poster depicted the Tower of London, and the idea of a story centered around the history of this structure arose. He brought the script to Sullivan, for it changed, was immensely pleased with the idea, stating it was a pretty story, not topsy-turvy-dum, very human and funny. Sullivan was inspired to compose one of his most imposing scores with a large orchestral scoring. This work is considered the most operatic of all of their joint efforts, and his most serious nature. The story is set during the 16th century, a nobleman condemned to death by a scheming relative on a trumped-up charge of sorcery. To foil this kinsman, he marries a wandering player, so that his inheritance will go to her. However, in a plot twist, some of his friends engineer a plan to help him escape by disguising him as a member of the yeomen who guard the tower. Now both partners find themselves trapped in the bonds of marriage to a stranger. The piece I'm presenting to you is Lament of Elsie, the bride who envies those wives who have married for love.
Writing what he considered to be light music. He viewed his prior collaborations with Gilbert is being dominated by Gilbert's librettos, and he felt his music was merely tacked on. It took the intervention of Doyle Cart to moderate the dispute and get the project moving along. The deal Cart managed to negotiate was like this. Sullivan would write the serious opera Iolanthe in as an opening for Cart's Royal English Opera House in exchange for writing one more work for the Savoy. Gilbert, for his part, bent over backwards to make sure that the project kept on going. He provided a setting in Venice, Italy, because he knew it would appeal to Sullivan. He also provided an opening of a full 20 minutes of music before any spoken dialogue, also designed to please Sullivan. Well, the results pleased audiences and critics alike, and even Queen Victoria requested a command performance at Windsor Castle. The story satirizes the appeal of a republican monarchy, where all roles, from the Lord Chamberlain to the cooks and the cleaning staff, are all considered equal. There are the marquis and the duke, the groom, the butler and the cook, the aristocrat who begs recruits, the aristocrat who cleans the boots, the noble lord who rules the state, the noble lord who cleans the grate, the lord who bears the birds, and thus the vagabond and the stars. For everyone who fears in time, supposed to undertake to fight, congenial with his brave of mind, congenial with his brave of mind, and all shall equal be. All shall equal be. It's a great song and a great story. The story is about two brothers who are gondoliers, and it is discovered that one of the brothers is of royal blood and is heir apparent to be king of the Spanish island nation of Barataria. But nobody knows which one it is, so until they discover which one should be king, it is decided that both of them should rule together as one individual. As it turns out, they have just gotten married in a joint wedding when, at the end of Act One, they are told they must be separated from their wives and sail away to Barataria and take up the position as king. Well, all are dismayed at the thought of being separated from their new spouses. And one of the wives, Ginetta, makes a plea with this aria. Kind sir, you cannot have the heart.
Look at them and pause before you deal this blow. Hi, I'm Tim Throckmorton. The Gondoliers ran for a full 554 performances, but things were not well between Gilbert and Sullivan by the end of this period. Gilbert had taken a cruise to India and returned to find out that without his input, the partnership had spent a large amount of money refurbishing the Savoy Theater, including new carpets in the lobby. He was infuriated by what he thought was Doily Carts and Sullivan's being in cahoots with each other at his expense. He announced he would no longer write for the Savoy as of the end of 1890. Gilbert stuck to this for a full 3 years before Doily Cart's wife, Helen, was finally able to bring them back together after both had produced works with other collaborators that were not especially successful. Also at this time, Sullivan's health was declining. The upshot of all of this was Utopia Limited, the story of a South Sea island that wishes to redesign its customs on the basis of an idealized Great Britain. To further this purpose, a group of British experts are hired to redo society. One of these is Captain Fitzbattleaxe of the Queen's First Lifeguards, who will reorganize the army. Captain Corcoran of Pinafore fame also appears to redesign the Navy, even doing a short reprise of his song from that show. Fitzbattleaxe is hopelessly in love with Princess Zara of the island, to the extent that he has lost his beautiful tenor technique.
Tempted sea. Repent not, mocking maid, thy curlhood's choice. The fervor of my love affects my voice. A tenor all singers above, this doesn't admit of a question, should keep himself quiet, attend to his diet, and carefully nurse his digestion. But when he is madly in love, it's certain to tell on his singing. You can't do chromatics with proper emphatics when anguish his bosom is wringing. When distracted by worries are plenty, and his pulse is 120, and his fluttering bosom the slave of mistrust is, a tenor can't do himself justice. Now observe. You see, I can't do myself justice. I could sing if my father were Mark. It's easy enough if you're acting. But when one's emotion is born of devotion, you mustn't be over-exacting. One ought to be firm as a rock, to venture a shake in vibrato. When fervor's expected, stay cool and collected, and never attempt agitato. But of course, when his tongue is of leather, and his lips appear pasted together,
and his sensitive palate, as dry as a crust is, a tenor can't do himself justice. Now observe. No use, I can't do myself justice.
I'm Dave Henderson, and I must now bring us to the final collaboration of Gilbert and Sullivan. Although Utopia Limited ran for a respectable 245 performances, it never really caught on to the same extent as most of their previous works. The lavishness of the production came to such a high cost that for the first time, the Savoy lost money on it. Public tastes had been changing over the 22 years that Gilbert and Sullivan had been working together, and their style of light opera was no longer popular. Even so, they made one more attempt 2 years later with The Grand Duke. At this point, Sullivan was suffering from severe kidney problems, Gilbert had gout, and Doyle Cart was also not well. It was another lavish production with an overly complicated plot, requiring a large cast of singers. Opening on March 7, 1896, it was to run for only 123 performances and then almost disappear from the repertoire. Only recently has it been staging a comeback, and now performances are no longer the rarity they once were, and many people have come to appreciate its good qualities. Strangely enough, the plot in many ways echoes that of their very first collaboration, Thespis. But instead of a group of players assuming the duties of the Olympian gods, this acting company must now take over the running of an impoverished Central European duchy. A visitor happens upon the scene, the Prince of Monte Carlo, and he has a solution for their fiscal difficulties, one that should sound very familiar to all of us these days. Establish a casino and play roulette.
Advice when deep in debt, set up a bank and play roulette. At once distrust you surely lull, and rook the pigeon and the gull. The bird will stake his every franc in wild attempt to break the bank, but you may stake your life and limb. The bank will end by breaking him. Allons a corps, a grâce au fiette, voluidon for une charrette. Hola, 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 hola. Let us pass a lava to casa. Rien ne va plus. L'année c'est noir, mon père manque. Hola, hola, vive la banca. A verb that when the board you spin, the bank is bound to win. For every time the board you spin, the bank is bound to win. A cosmic game is this roulette. The little ball's a true coquette, a maiden coy whom numbers woo, whom 36 suit or sue. Of all complexions, two good lack, for some are red and some are black, and some must be extremely green, for half of them are not 19. Allons a corps, a grâce au fiette, voluidon for une charrette. Hola, 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 hola. Let us a cool, rien ne va plus. L'automne s'écrouge, au père passe. Très bien étudiant de la classe. For moral safe when you begin, the bank is bound to win. The moral safe when you begin, the bank is bound to win. The little ball's afloat in bread. She flirts with black, she flirts with red. From this to that she hops about, and back to this as if in doubt. The call her thoughtless were unkind. The child is making up her mind. For all the world, like all the rest, which prétendant will pay the best. Allons a corps, a grâce au fiette, voluidon pour une charrette. Hola, 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 hola. can you tell me? Rien ne va plus. Tra la la la, la double zero. Vous perdez tout mes double zero. For every time the board you spin, the bank is bound to win. For every time the board you spin, the bank is bound.
And so there you have it. Sullivan was to die in November of 1900 and Doyley Cart only 6 months later. Gilbert, however, soldiered on and continued writing and directing works for the stage. He also oversaw revivals of many of their joint works with the Doyley Cart Opera Company. He was to die at the age of 74 when he had a heart attack while trying to rescue a young woman who was in difficulty swimming in the lake at his home at Grimsdyke. We hope you have enjoyed this presentation and will continue to support us in our endeavors to bring you the works of this remarkable team in the future. We will now end the video with a video clip from our 2016 production of Pirates of Penzance featuring our society's theme song, Hail Poetry. Thank you.